Welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. I'm Simi. Let's see what's coming up on today's programme. Doctors in Uganda are fighting the deadly Ebola virus. We'll have the latest and find out how vaccines are starting to help. We'll be joining one of Nigeria's top young gymnasts.
I look up to God, my parents and Simon Boss.
We meet a TikToker who has a lot of wigs and a lot of wit. Debbie Oscar tells us all about her journey into comedy.
Seeing a lot of aunties seeing my content, a lot of aunties and uncles in Africa seeing my content and being able to laugh at it and not go, this is disrespectful. My son is a doctor, how dare you?
Uganda is currently tackling an outbreak of Ebola, one of the world's deadliest diseases. Here's Kesha to explain everything you need to know about the virus, including symptoms, how people catch it, and how to stop it spreading.
My body was rejecting me because my kidneys were down, my liver was down. At one point, I was scared, thinking that maybe we were going to die.
Hudson caught Ebola whilst tackling the disease in Uganda.
We thank God for your life.
Ebola has caused over 30 outbreaks in sub-Saharan Africa since the virus was discovered in 1976. It was first found in the Democratic Republic of Congo and Sudan. The worst outbreak was between 2014 and 2016 in West Africa, when more than 11,000 people died.
You see how much it impacts people's lives, and people are losing mothers and grandmothers and fathers and brothers, and it's heartbreaking.
So what is Ebola?
Ebola is a zoonotic virus, meaning that it's an animal-borne virus that can be spread to human beings. The most likely reservoir for Ebola are bats. Ebola is almost exclusively transmitted by direct contact with bodily fluids from either people or animals.
The Zaire strain of Ebola is the most deadly and transmissible. Uganda's most recent outbreak is caused by the Sudan strain. It's less common and transmissible, but can be deadly, with a fatality rate of 40 to 100%. But both strains have similar symptoms.
Ebola has both dry and wet symptoms. The dry symptoms include fever, aches and pains, and fatigue. The wet symptoms include diarrhea and vomiting, as well as unexplained hemorrhaging and bleeding and bruising.
So how can the spread of Ebola be stopped? There are now two vaccines to help tackle outbreaks of Zaire Ebola, but a vaccine for the Sudan strain has not yet been approved.
The most important thing at the moment is strong health systems and surveillance systems to detect an emerging outbreak as soon as possible. When you talk about fatality rates, they can be reduced by having people in the hospital that are getting rehydration or getting their symptoms taken care of, and to make sure that that person isn't going to infect someone else unknowingly.
Our next guest knows how to balance, tumble, and roll. Stephanie is an incredible gymnast and won her first international gold medal when she was just 8 years old. We caught up with her at training.
My name is Stephanie. I'm 12 years old and I'm a gymnast. Gymnastics is a fun, interesting sport that I love to do, and it really motivates me to be a world champion. I started flipping when I was younger at home, so my mom now stopped me because she thought I was going to injure myself. She now took me to a gymnasium in 2018 when I was 7 years old, and that's when I started professional gymnastics. The apparatus involved in gymnastics is floor, beam, bars, and vaults. Gymnastics is fun because I like learning new skills on each apparatus. I can do double back, I can do double pike on floor. On bars, I can do my giants. On beam, I can do back crossover to double twist out. On vault, I can do sukara. My favorite apparatus is bars.
Push! Bring it! Sink!
I love the bars because it's more easier for me. I've been to a lot of competitions like the last National Sports Festival, South African trip in 2019, and also Ilorin. I represented Nigeria in the African Club Championships in South Africa at a club level. I like representing Nigeria because I want to make my country proud. I've won so many medals that I can't even remember. In 2019, I won a bronze medal in Ilorin Youth Games. In the last National Sports Festival I won 2 silvers, a bronze medal and a gold medal. In the last South African competition, I won a gold medal. Gymnastics is more difficult in some ways if you don't put your mind to it. You put your mind to it if you keep on focusing on what your coach tells you to do so you can be able to learn new skills. You have to face your fears in doing new skills. You need a lot of consistency and strength, and also flexibility, and also endurance, so that in case of any routines and competitions, you'll be able to have enough energy to do the routines. Whenever I'm not doing gymnastics, I'm at home playing with my siblings with their other sports. I look up to God, my parents, and Simone Biles. I want to be like Simone Biles because she's a world champion and I also want to be a world champion. I would like to go for the next Commonwealth Games and also World Championships. I would like to go to the Olympics when I'm 15 years old. I would like to see myself in the future being a world champion in gymnastics.
Now, would you believe me if I said this is only one of the many faces of Debbie Oscar? Well, Debbie is a Nigerian and Italian TikTok comedian who gained enormous popularity by creating funny monologues. Our reporter Stefania met Debbie to find out how a trip to Nigeria gave her a new sense of purpose to start this career.
Joanna, Pieta, come, follow me. I will make you fish.
How much?
Excuse me? No, you want us to drop work and follow you? How much?
Debbie Oscar is a girl you should never take serious. I will never be serious a day in my life. I'm someone who is easygoing. I just want to have fun, enjoy my life.
How can you best define your work, your content, and when did it all start?
January 2021. I came back from Nigeria feeling inspired, feeling like I wanted to touch homage to who I am as a person. And so I just started doing content on TikTok as a joke.
Hello, wait, Kichi, you not kill me?
And then it wasn't until April that I started doing it like as a career because I realized the potential.
Help!
What happened?
Someone took my car!
Why are you just standing there? Call the police!
Are you not the police?
Hello, it's true.
Hurry!
You are a multilingual and multicultural person.
Yes.
How do you use different part of yourself to relate to the audience?
Well, I was born and raised in Italy. Then, of course, I'm Nigerian. And then I lived in London for a long time. So I have 3 sides of me. This one, you're wearing red lipstick. What's happening? You're wearing red. The Italian is the hands, which viene a mangiare, il mangiare pronto, mangi, 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 which is something my mom used to say, and now I'm fat. Eat, eat. and then of course the British is very, I always do the British as organized and very rude. Darling, just log out for me. Log out for me, darling. Just don't come back.
You mean it?
What inspires your creativity and what is the process like?
To be honest, I get creativity from everywhere. I could be reading the news and then bam, something will come up from there. Or from trends, things that are happening in the news.
Mummy?
Yes?
Why did auntie and uncle name their daughter Rihanna?
I guess because they really liked Rihanna, the artist.
Oh, and what about my name?
R. Kelly, go to your room and stop asking stupid questions.
And is there something you won't joke about?
What would I not joke about? To be honest, I've touched things that people wouldn't normally joke about. But again, I come to it not in a rude way. Mm. It's most likely in a, we've all thought of this, but I'm just posting it.
I'll see you later. Okay, bye, 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 bye. Oh my God.
Oh. Life can be so grim. And sometimes we forget to laugh.
Take me a picture.
Okay, ma'am.
With your nice camera.
for my WhatsApp.
Yes, ma'am.
Seeing a lot of aunties seeing my content, a lot of aunties and uncles in Africa seeing my content and being able to laugh at it and not go, this is disrespectful. Okay, so now they're like, you know what? Just do your thing. Like, I trust you. I've had job offers, especially in Nigeria and Nollywood. A few producers and directors have come in contact with me just from seeing my content. And also like stand-up, which I never thought of doing.
Something Nyash repair you told
us. I said hernia repair.
A lot of times we tend to look away from where we are. Like, we tend to focus on what other people have and what other people's opportunities are. But I truly believe that there's opportunities right on your doorstep.
I said I cannot help her because my hands are tied.
How?
Literally. I lost the keys.
Swahili is the most spoken African language, and Uganda is the latest country to adopt it as an official language. It's now compulsory for primary and secondary students to learn Swahili. We spoke to a few students in the capital, Kampala, to find out how they feel about learning the language and being taught it in their classrooms.
I know words like habari, where you answer zuri, that's a greeting.
Jambo. I think it means like greetings, we are kind of greeting.
Umoja, I think means one.
For respect, you say shikamo and they answer marahaba.
Macho mbele, meaning eyes forward, I think.
So I know kandanda. Kandanda is a sport, it's football.
And also hakuna matata, which means no worries.
There are over 200 million people just in Africa alone that speak Swahili because the language is so widespread.
Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, Kenya, whoa, those are the countries in which you will find like the most dominant speakers of Kiswahili language.
I actually have used Kiswahili before in my primary school. We used to learn Kiswahili as a subject and I had a passion to learn it.
Since we studied Kiswahili at school in our new best curriculum, we kind of use it to interact with ourselves, like us and the students, and the teacher.
When I moved on to upper secondary, we did not offer Kiswahili, but I had roommates from Tanzania and Kenya who used Kiswahili a lot, so I picked up a few phrases.
Talking to my Tanzanian friends, you know, they know it more than me, but sometimes you just want to fit in, then you'd be like, hi, in Kiswahili, you'd be like, ujambo.
For example, when the teacher tells us to stand up, he will basically say simama. Then this is to go to the board and maybe like participate.
My roommates were Tanzanian and Kenyan, so they had that bond. And I normally would feel left out because they would forget, I don't know Kiswahili. And I'd have to stand there looking completely confused and have to ask them to translate. So it kind of creates a barrier, a wall of communication, which is not really friendly for either end.
My dad has always tried to motivate me to learn Kiswahili.
They actually encourage us a lot, and I was actually interested from a young age in learning a language that's African besides my own and besides English.
At home, my younger brothers, all of them who are studying in secondary, are taking up that language.
My father himself speaks Kiswahili really fluently. My mother took a course to learn Kiswahili, although she didn't finish it. I'm speaking English and you're speaking Kiswahili, there is no interaction or there is no physical bond or emotional bond you make with someone. Because back in my mother country, in Burundi, Kiswahili is used quite a lot. So when I go back home and I can't, I'm not able to relate with my own people.
If I have this Kiswahili with me, I'm going to be at a higher advantage compared to that person without me. So I see myself getting better job opportunities across the continent. I see myself talking well, like easily with my friends. Maybe one day I own a business in the future and I'm going to trade with African states. Yes, that's it.
Since it's now more like a national language for all African states, now just imagine a world like whereby all African states are united by one language. To me, on my perspective, I'm looking at it as something that's going to boom the whole continent. In fact, boom the whole world.
Egyptian artist Wegs has quickly taken over the rap scene across North Africa. You may have heard of his song El Bakt, which now has over 154 million views on YouTube alone. Our reporter Sherry Han spoke to him about his art and what lies ahead.
He's kind of a role model.
With a few songs, he just made it.
Gives us like hope to carry on.
The rap scene across North Africa has been expanding not just throughout the continent, but the entire world. I mean, look at the crowds. They're here to see one man in particular who decided to make Egyptian music part of this exciting journey. Who am I talking about? Well, let me show you.
I'm just 24 years old who's trying to be better. This is my aim. I mean, I've been trying to just work on myself. This is what I really am.
Do you ever feel scared, you know, having such responsibility, such mass following?
Yeah, it's kind of a big wall for the creative process if you think of it. Because you don't want to influence people of the bad things, and not everyone is just the good person, you know. It makes you look to yourself in a deeper way, knowing what you really are and knowing what you really don't want other people to just copy from you. Rap wasn't everyone's music in Egypt. I mean, everyone has a different taste. So people might listen to something different, that's all. I spent most of my childhood listening to rap music. Like Mobb Deep was really, I don't know, it was something that I liked. I found the heat in it. And Justin Bieber, of course, because he's such a lizard. He can just change color in any minute. Drake is also nice. He can change. I like it when an artist can just change. It takes a while to learn how to just do music that is gonna go international. You have to make something that everyone would like. And no matter how talented you are in just certain genres, doesn't mean you're good at everything. But this is what I'm working on. I really want to make a song of everything. I really want to just go outside, because this is the real challenge, to get yourself outside of your comfort zone. I love to put something Egyptian in my song, and I would also just do a different beat that is out there because I can. It might sound nice and people in Egypt might like it, really, because they listen to international music with a guy with a different language singing, so why cannot just do that too, right? You being an Egyptian rapper, I think it's a gift, because you already don't have to explain to the region. Everyone kind of gets it. The youth in this region, they kind of have the same music. Like right now, if you are Egyptian, you might listen to something from Sudan or Saudi or Jordan, or yeah, because it's Arabic. I mean, they listen to our music, so we listen to their music. I listen to everything. Dizzy, Yaltug, Omalaise on a come up, Burna Boy, of course. There's like a bunch of names, a bunch of big names. This is what's popping, really, Afro music. I also want to just get to know the culture just a little bit more. I just want to spend some time there. I just need to talk to the people. Okay, what is the connection? What is the song's gonna be about? You don't want me talking about something that none of the boys in Nigeria know about, none of the boys in Ghana know about. I want everyone to just listen to it. Egypt is also filled with people. There's a bunch of new artists that want to come up. Hussein, Flix, and Super Dizzy. Shabjdeed, Nazir, Adabur. These are like the actual Arab names that really have a story to tell, I think.
I wanted to ask you about the food that you had here. I had the impression that you're not very happy with it.
No. Someone needs to come from Egypt and just teach everyone.
What Egyptian meals
Egyptian
are you missing?
Egyptian meals, Lebanese meal. I mean, there's some really good food. I'd be like, this is really underrated, right? But yeah, it's just maybe what I'm used to. I don't really like to just discover new food, and no, I like to discover new areas, but new food is,
you know,
I eat to survive. I eat to just to keep going. So I want to eat the things that I really like.
Eagle, birdie, double eagle. I'm not bird spotting, but did you know these are all terms for when you score points in golf? Our next guest, Peter, is from Nakuru in Kenya. Here he is to show us how it's done.
Hi, my name is Peter. I'm 11 years old and I'm a golfer. Been a good boy. I started golf when I was 7. I stopped at 8 years because of COVID. Then I came at last year when I was 10 years. And I love golf because I'm enjoying it. It's athletics and you make more friends in it. 50 yards. Landed short because it's yellow. Remove the pin. I've won more than 10 competitions, 2 major ones for Safaricom and Nation. My ambition is to be a professional golfer and to play for Kenya. I don't think golf is for rich people. If you're more interested in golf, you can grow your talent and win more competitions. And here in Kenya, juniors can get a membership for Junior Golf Foundation for a low amount of money. My role models are Rory McIlroy, Justin Thomas, and Mutai Kibugu.
Nice.
The advice I will give to young golfers, don't be mad when you hit a bad shot. Enjoy the game of golf and practice, practice, practice makes perfect.
Well, that's all from the BBC What's New team this week. See you next time. Bye.